Thank you. Thanks. So it's my pleasure to be here tonight. And I figured I'd start by talking a little bit about why I chose this topic. I've been asked this a number of times. And basically the first song I remember hearing was Strawberry Fields Forever. I was about 4 or 5 years old. And I'd expressed an that's right. And it was I'd somehow figured out, it's a little hazy, but I'd somehow figured out how to play a little bit of A Day in the Life on piano and sing it. It was clearly something that was in our house all the time. And my dad came running down. He's, oh, that's great. You know, you like the Beatles. It was probably the first thing where we'd actually connected. And so he immediately ran out and bought the the Blue Greatest Hits record and Magical Mystery Tour. And I just remember him putting on Strawberry Fields Forever and watching the record go around, which never happens anymore, and just being absolutely blown away. I gotta tell you, at first it sounded really weird. the voices sounded sped up and then slowed down, and it turns out that they were sped up and slowed down. But in any event, so that sparked a lifelong interest in the Beatles. I remember, you know, being 6, 7 years old and figuring out how to, again, my poor father, figuring out how to dismantle his record player and then put it back together in the on our deck so that I could have it on while I was playing in the backyard in like the sandbox, so I could have the Beatles blaring, you know. So anyways, yeah, and it sparked a lifelong interest. It was a way that, you know, the Beatles and Bob Dylan were a way that my father and I really connected, I suppose. And we didn't really connect in a lot of other ways. So it was something that I really cherished, he really cherished. And I just got more and more interested in the mythology behind the records. Pink Floyd and the Beatles tend to be these two bands where there's all this mythology around their records, and their records are treated as almost, you know, totemic. You listen to their records and it's like a ritual. I don't know whether that's the case anymore, but certainly was the case when I was growing up. Anyways, and so everything was great in my household until I said, well, that's it. I'm going to do this for a living. And then that was the end of it. But anyway, so I went to Berkeley. I studied songwriting, I studied production and engineering, and much as what was going on then and what's going on now is fascinating, there's just something about these records that I find really interesting. I think you can hear the influence of these records in pretty much everything today. I'm willing to talk to people who are fans of hip hop, and we can find common ground. I often do this, in fact. And so I think George Martin's influence is way larger than he often gets credit for, even just within the whole Beatles mythos. I mean, we call him the Fifth Beatle, but often we call him that as an honorary title, and I think actually it's an accurate title. So that's my plan tonight. All I really want to do is do my best to get you thinking that perhaps the concept of George Martin as the Fifth Beatle is not just an honorary designation, but is an accurate description of what he did. That he was, in fact, especially once the Beatles stopped performing live, he was, in fact, a productive member of the band and played a really important role in shaping their musical communications. And I'm going to try to also, there is one point where we're going to get a little academic, sorry, but we're going to pull back and try to figure out why it is that we don't immediately hear that influence, why our ears are drawn to the things that Lennon and McCartney did initially, and we can so easily appreciate that, and why we have to do some reading to understand what George Martin did and what Jeff Emerick and Ken Townsend and Norman Smith and all the engineers there did. So hopefully I'll complicate our idea of authorship when it comes to the Beatles records. How am I going to do that? I've got to bend down here every time. I'll give you a bit of context, so we'll figure out why the Beatles stopped performing live, because that's when we're going to pick them up. In order to get what I want to get across with George Martin, we have to kind of reorient ourselves to what a record is, what music is. And then hopefully if we can get our gear running, we're going to give you some demonstrations of certain key techniques that George Martin and Jeff Emerick and crew really innovated so that make them perfectly obvious, and then we'd hear them on a Beatles track. But if not, we'll have to talk you through it. So you have to bear with us. So to start with a little bit of context, in 1966, everybody knows the Beatles stopped performing live. This, I think, is a really important moment in musical history, and I really fixated on that moment throughout all of my studies and was absolutely confused why very few other people did. It's a really key moment. We have a band here who is at the pinnacle of success, and they declare that the live concert, the way that music has traditionally been done, isn't necessary anymore. We don't have to do that. Not only that, John Lennon, as we'll see, was really outspoken in how, in almost his distaste for live performance and the live concert experience. Some people have seen a bit of the aristocrat in that, not wanting to mill about with the general public. It's not exactly a flattering take on it. As a performing musician myself, I can tell you that I never liked to perform live, hated it. It was nerve-wracking. And you didn't have the same control that you have in the studio over the actual musical communication. You can be much more thorough, more experimental. And we're going to get at some other reasons. Obviously, at some point, he feared for his life. But the important point here is that once the Beatles stopped performing live, they became a George Martin production. And that's really important to keep in mind. This band no longer performed live. We're talking about a time when if an engineer wanted to place a microphone in close proximity to a particularly loud sound source, which is now what you do, at Abbey Road, or what became Abbey Road, where the Beatles recorded, they needed to get written permission to do this. That's how regimented and bureaucratic the recording session was back in the day. And so a band like the Beatles, who we expect that their every artistic whim would be indulged, fine, you know, they were absolutely indulged rock stars, but really outside of the studio. You know, we hear these stories about how long they took in the studio, but when they were in the studio, George Martin was making sure that they were working. And so this was they were on contract, and this is what they did for a living, and George Martin was the one they relied on to maintain order. It's a different take on the Beatles, but this is what I'm saying. Tonight, why not have a bit of fun? Follow me along. I'm going to try to convince you that they do become a George Martin production. That's not to say that what they do is not absolutely crucial, right? And that, you know, Lennon McCartney songs aren't great, etc., etc. It's just to say that when you only communicate by making records, the person producing that record deserves authorial credit too. It's like movies. We very easily make the leap from, we very easily make the distinction between a live dramatical performance and film, right? We know that there's a director behind the film, and of course when the Best Picture Oscar is given out, normally it's the director who receives most of the accolades, right? We have a difficult time making that leap with records and live performances, I think. And the producer's role is less clear to us. So.
How old was, George Martin?
He was older than the Beatles. He had already been working for roughly close to a decade. And he was actually head of the label. And and as a matter of fact, the relationship that they had with him was closer to headmaster schoolboy by everyone's account than anything else. In fact, George Martin was fine with a little marijuana here and there, but you know, once they got into dropping acid and doing the records, they hid it from George Martin. And he had a real distaste for it. And so clearly he was part of a different generation. Yep. So why did they quit performance? I think it's important that we dwell on this moment and that we get a bit of context. I tend not to be an ism guy. There's a real clear human motivation for this, I think. One, it's a pain in the butt to be touring all the time. And two, I think John Lennon in particular felt very conspicuous. And here's a quote from Flip Out, a teen magazine published in May of 1966, where John says, "If I thought I'd go through the rest of my life being pointed and stared at, I'd give up the Beatles now. It's only the thought that one day it will all come to an end which keeps me going." Typical optimistic. And then, of course, we have the infamous "We're bigger, bigger than Jesus" quote, right? And so the actual quote comes out in a British paper in March, but it doesn't appear in the States until July. And it's not really until it appears in the States in July that it sparks such a furor. And it just so happens that the Beatles are on tour then. And this is what's said. Yeah, it's a pretty grainy photo, sir, but that's the actual shot. I don't know which will go first, rock and roll or Christianity, it reads. And this is the actual quote. "Christianity will go, it will vanish and shrink. I needn't argue with that. I'm right and I will be proven right. We're more popular than Jesus now. I don't know which will go first, rock and roll or Christianity. Jesus was all right, but his disciples were thick and ordinary. It's them twisting it that ruins it for me." And then so we get, you know, Beatle burnings, go home Beatles, and at some point members of the KKK show up, and they at a concert, and there's video footage of them basically saying, "We have ways of dealing with you know, Beatles," and basically they threaten to blow up the stadium, and the Beatles. Members of the Beatles talk about this as being a really terrifying time. They'd go on stage and they, you know, John Lennon was pretty convinced that he was going to get popped. And that's not a happy situation for anyone. So I think at some point it strikes them, we don't have to do this. No one can hear us, right? And that's another thing he says. So what they're doing, what they're saying is that, so Glenn Gould often, it gets credited as the first to really mention this, that the live concert performance is a dying ritual. That it made a lot of sense in previous times, but now we live in an age when we can mass produce our communications. That doesn't mean broadcast, but we can mass produce records. And because that's our context, we live in this technological context, it makes sense that our musical communications would be so technologically mediated. We don't have to do this. And so the Beatles, it's an experiment when they really retire, and they become, again, a George Martin production, and they demonstrate that this is indeed the case. Success in musical communications can be had just by making records. That's actually a really revolutionary thing that often gets glossed over in all the stories that go on around the Beatles at this time. So we're going to watch a little segment now, which will give us context where the... does anyone know this episode? The B-sharps? It's in this bigger than Jesus is a the whole episode is a notorious moment in rock history. So notorious, in fact, that when Homer Simpson tops the charts, they call their number one record bigger than Jesus, right? So it's a little inelegant, but I have to cross over to iTunes really quickly to show some of these videos. And we're going to show a little snippet now of a documentary, which is detailing the tumult surrounding their final tour, and gives a bit of context to why a band, a group of musicians who make their living performing music, would find it desirable not to do that in, you know, anywhere but in the studio anymore. Because it's a really interesting thing when you think about it. Well, you know, would I like to be an academic professor who talks to tape all day and just distributes my lectures by tape? Well, yeah, because I could work 2 days out of the year, you know. But I don't know if that's what I want, you know. It's something to think about.
Some teenagers have said that every beat of your statements that the Beatles, "I like the Beatles more than Jesus Christ." What do you think about that?
Well, originally I was pointed out that fact in reference to England, that we meant more to kids than Jesus did, or religion at that time. I wasn't knocking it or putting it down, I was just saying it. But the fact,
how are we doing?
And it sort of, it is true that's more for England than here. You know, I'm not saying that we're better or greater, or comparing us with Jesus Christ as a person, or God as a thing, or whatever it is. You know, I've just said what I said, it was wrong, or was taken wrong, and now it's all this.
The quote which John Lennon made to a London columnist more than 3 months ago has been quoted and represented entirely out of context.
He just thought, how can anyone have misconstrued what he said? I felt desperate, we all did, for John at that time. He never meant it like that. He said, "Oh, Julia, I never, never meant to offend anybody at any time with that remark, and it was as big a shock to him as anything else."
I think he was jealous of Jesus for many years. if you understand what I mean. You're just, you know, envious of the ever having been a Jesus. Jesus is what he would have liked to have been. A guitar playing Jesus.
I was with John when he did this interview. It was just an innocent thing that John said. And I mean, interviews after that, when we go to America and in the South, the DJs and that are saying, bring out your records and all your albums and stuff like that, and they were destroying stuff in the streets, you know. Where are all these people today? The Beatles live on, you know.
Actually, if any of the promoters were so concerned, and it was their wish that a concert should be cancelled, I wouldn't in fact stand in their way. As a matter of fact, the Memphis concert, which is nearest to the place where this broke out, apparently sold more tickets yesterday than they had done up until that date.
This is John Beckman and Tommy Charles reminding you that our fantastic Beatle boycott is still in effect. Don't you forget what the Beatles have said. Don't forget to take your Beatle records and your Beatle paraphernalia to any one of our 14 pickup points in Birmingham, Alabama, and turn them this week if possible.
Yeah, you might go to the Beatles, you know, because they take things so seriously, you know, on the street, you know, and they realize they wasn't that important. So, I didn't want to go, but Brian and another people persuaded me to help me. I can't stick now. I'm as lucky to say that the press conference is on film, but I'm so saying, oh, hey, Moses, I wasn't joking a little bit in Jesus. I just say one of the famous kids from Western North Jesus. I mean, going through this sort of hypocrisy and terrified, you know, like really scared. One night on the show in the South somewhere, somebody let off a firecracker while we were on stage, and I'd been dressed to shoot us. The camera burning Beatle records outside, and I was too.
I have to say, coming along sort of decades after that, I find that image really shocking. You're burning records with the KKK. It's like kind of, I can't imagine anybody sparking off that much controversy on such a wide scale today. So, I don't know what to make of it. But in any event, except for to say that in the context of this discussion, it was enough to make John Lennon and the Beatles say, you know what? We're just not going to do this for a while.
Ask the Dixie Chicks what they think.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, but you don't have the KKK burning records and, you know, blowing up records. I think it's more than just the media saying, you know, we dislike you really vehemently. You have groups of people getting together and burning your records. It's like book burnings, you know? Anyways, and now it's a joke on The Simpsons, so. There we go. Always, of course, too, the other thing is John Lennon always said, I didn't mean anything by this, you know, I was so terrified. And then you have in the ballad of you can't really see that, can you? In the ballad of John and Yoko, he has this kind of open letter to Jesus, and he said, Christ, you know it ain't easy, you know how hard it can be. The way things are going, they're going to crucify me. So he has that peace sign up with one hand, and the other hand, he's sort of poke, you know.
No, but the thing is, they can put Christ in a urine, a crucifix in urine, and most Christians don't really, they're not burning any books or anything. So today's completely different.
Sure, absolutely. That's right. And the other thing, too, is that one of the things that often gets repeated with rock music at that point in time with the controversy is, won't someone see, you know, think of the children, the influence these people have over our kids. I think Christ in the urinal... yeah, it's a pretty shocking image, but, you know, it's clearly kind of fringe art, right, in compared to, like, top 40 rock. But absolutely, it's an interesting thing. Anyways, at that point, they decide they're not going to perform live anymore. So we go from this to this. That's what musical communication becomes. From that moment on, the Beatles, once they stop performing live, they sing to microphones and tapes. And that's really important to keep in mind, because someone like George Martin then is gonna come along and put that microphone and tape and all the arsenal of technologies and people into the service of creating a record which can put you in the mind of this. Oh, can put you in the mind of this, right? But again, these are mass-produced things which you put in your stereo And they're basically these hard drives designed to make your speakers vibrate in particular ways. That's what they are. Right, that's what a record is. If you think about it, your stereo system will not work without the product that record labels give you, right? Even iPods will not work without content. They're manufactured to lack this one particular component. And that's what recording artists make, right? That's what a record is. It's basically a software designed to vibrate speaker or headphone diaphragms in particular ways. Okay. All right. After that point, Martin becomes the gatekeeper for all Beatles communications. There was a ritual that the Beatles had, which went like this from the very beginning. One member, whoever wrote the song, would walk into the live room, sit on a stool or stand, and play the song with an acoustic guitar to George Martin, and George Martin would say yes or no. Rarely did he say no. Rarely did he say no. He was dealing with the Beatles after all. But sometimes he did say no, and songs just never made it. Very often he would say, that sounds good, but it needs more work. Or, that's fine, but we need a bridge, right? So, he was the gatekeeper. Again, this is something that we see, the myth, one of the most popular myths in rock and roll is the myth of the genius, and not only that, the Promethean genius, right? Who gives some sort of truth to all of society and has to pay the price for it. That's why we love it when rock stars die young. It's very Promethean. They suffer for their insight. And this sort of thing really challenges that, because George Martin worked on behalf of a record label which at one point in time he owned, and he was purely interested in, will this move units? Of course, with the Beatles he trusted their instincts, but again, he did not trust their instincts over his own, and in the context of the recording studio, the producer George Martin has final say. And he did say no from time to time. Just like during the mastering sessions, so the Beatles used tape in the studio, but people listened to vinyl records. If there was too much bass on your vinyl record, it could bump the needle right off the groove, because bass frequencies are very large. And this was clearly a concern, because if you buy a record from Parlophone or EMI, and it keeps bumping off the groove, you're not gonna buy another record from them. They can't make a record that works, right? So they would hire these mastering engineers to make sure that the transfer from tape to vinyl didn't produce these bumps and these skips. So during the mastering sessions, very famously, Paul McCartney, who played bass, would sit there and say, Norman Smith initially did this, and he'd say, Norman, more bass? And Norman would say, we can't, and Paul would say, you must, and Norman would say, no, we can't, and there'd be this long argument. And of course, you know, John Lennon, oh, here we go. They can't do the bass, it'll break the record. Paul, we need more bass. So in any event, Paul was told no too. You know, ultimately the record label ruled at this point. And it's only later on, we forget that it's really only, the Beatles try to go off on their own with Let It Be and to sort of circumvent this because it really grates them. But ultimately it doesn't happen. It doesn't happen until later. So George Martin is the gatekeeper, first of all. And you can see here's a really telling picture. They're in the studio and they're trying to discuss how to get a song in final recorded shape. And they're not talking to each other, they're talking to George in turn. So, all musical communications between Beatles and audience members then from roughly the acid rock period on are mediated by George Martin, his engineers, Jeff Emmerich, Ken Townsend, Norman Smith, among others, and the available technology. So, let's hear what a recorded communication sounds like. We're gonna hear a track from Andrew Bird Can Sing, which is Revolver era, roughly right before they retire. And we're gonna hear vocals, and then the electric guitar part, and then vocals and the electric guitar part, and then vocals and electric guitar line. And really what I want you to get from, the sound quality is awful. I have to apologize up front for that. The sound quality is awful on this. The conversion process added some digital hair. But what I want you to get from this is that how very piecemeal these tracks were put together the second that technology allowed them to do something called overdubbing. Does anyone not know what overdubbing is? All right, overdubbing, basically you have a certain amount of tracks available to you. So let's say we have four tracks available to me on the tape we're using to create this record. We use those four tracks, we'll just say, to record the drums, bass, and guitar, but not the vocals, okay? So we put these down on three tracks, and we go through the song, and we perform it, and it's great. There was a little glitch, though, in my guitar line, so we go back on the bridge, and we rewind the tape, and then we get to the bridge area, and then I press record again, and I record over that part, a new part, or I dub a new part over the old part. That's called overdubbing. This became the way that we made records, and it's called the multi-track paradigm. You didn't think linearly anymore, that I'm gonna write a song, and it's gonna go from A to B, and that's it, I'm done. The way people started to think was, I need to write a song for record, right? So it sounds good on record, and it makes sense on record. And part of that is figuring out how to write songs that are conducive to, say, overdubbing in these large arrangements and whatnot. So, what we're going to hear is a bit of the working method, this method at work, and this was also something to keep in mind. This is the emergence of that paradigm. It hasn't really existed before, and it's not just because the technology didn't exist. The technology actually existed to do multiple passes or overdubs, multi-tracking, for a few years before bands like the Beatles took it up. So now we'll hear Andrew Bird Can Sing. Again, apologies for the quality. All I want you to do is really listen and really think about the fact that this is kind of a component assembly line approach to putting a song together, and in doing that, communicating musically. It's a very industrial approach to making music when you think about it. So what you'll hear is quietly in the background the tracks that they recorded initially, the original tracks. These are called reference tracks. And Revolver's also an innovative moment in recording history because the band started using headphones in the studio. And they used headphones because if you were to play the track and then sing over it and record it, you might record another copy of the initial track slightly out of time. And this produces all kinds of distortions that sound terrible. So they started, you know, we see the image, the popular image of the musician with headphones in the studio. This is an outgrowth of this multi-track approach to recording this overdubbing. So let's hear what, you know, part of that assembly line, what this pass, what this unit of Andrew Bird Can Sing sounded like. And, you know, keep in mind too, these are great vocal performances, great guitar performances too. So that's the reference, very quiet. Sorry, it's awful. Tell me that you got everything you want, and you're back and sing, but you don't get me. You don't get me. You say you've seen seven wonders, and your bed is green, but you can't see me. Also, something telling you about the time. Track space was still limited, and that's why Paul McCartney and John Lennon are singing those harmonies at the same time. Nowadays, that's an increasingly lost art form, because one person sings one line, they get that perfect, and then the other person comes in and sings the second line, overdubs it. You can't see me when your prized possessions stop to weigh down. Look in my direction, I'll be round, I'll be round. You tell me that you heard every sound there is, and your bird can swing, but you can't hear me. You can't hear me. Thank you. All right, so that's enough of that. Now, what I also want to do, just to reinforce this point, is we're going to watch a little video of Hey Bullfrog. Everyone knows the tune Hey Bullfrog? We're going to watch. This video is compiled entirely of video footage of the band working in the studio creating this track. And again, it's just a really, I want you to think about what you're seeing. You're seeing two people singing to a microphone, and then somewhere down the hall, the drums, and then somewhere down the hall, a guitar, and then they switch out the guitar, and then we go back. And of course, it's all put together to look and sound like a live performance, right? Oops. Oh, sorry, something else to keep in mind. You're gonna see John Lennon, ever the student, with the lyrics on a sheet of paper, and he's reading it as he's singing. That's like, you know, you watch Saturday Night Live and you can tell the guy is reading the prompter. That wouldn't fly at a live performance, right? I mean, it just wouldn't fly. You'd want your money back. You don't know what it's like to listen to your peers. You can talk to me. You can talk to me. You can talk to me. If you're lonely, you can talk to me. So this piecemeal approach to production would reach, as far as I'm concerned, its apex with I Am The Walrus. Another track I was absolutely obsessed with as a kid. I couldn't tell you why, but I would just go, this thing was like sonic LSD. You know, I understood the whole psychedelic experience at 6 years old listening to this thing. but enjoyable. Anyway, think about the way that this track is put together. We're going to listen to it, and I'm going to try to keep this up there so that we can keep this in mind. The Beatles are working with four-track tape at this point. That means that they have four tracks at their disposal, and you know, the crew at Abbey Road, being as industrious as they are, they could sometimes figure out how to link together these tapes so they could have eight tracks at their disposal. The way that they made this work to make these massive productions work is that they would do something called bouncing down. You would have your four tracks on one tape, and then you would pull up a second four-track machine, and you would take those four tracks, or whichever tracks you liked, and you would record them onto the next machine on, say, two open tracks. That gives you two more tracks. You do that again, and you can bounce it back to the next. That gives you, and you're at six tracks, and then you have, you know, say, one more open. There's a problem here. Tape has some tape has a low frequency bias, which is to say that the higher frequencies tend to get rolled off, or for our purposes, erased or smudged out every time you do one of these bounces. And that's a problem, because you can't go back when you're bouncing down and say, oh, you know, I want to change that tambourine part's not sounding so it's not cutting through the mix anymore, I need to change that. Can't do that, because you're mixing as you go. So it was a real skill to be able to do this, first of all, and that's something that at Abbey Road, George Martin, Jeff Emmerich, Ken Townsend, they really mastered. But the other thing was that you really had to be thoughtful about what you were doing, and you mixed as you went. But still, that's, you know, the for instance, with I Am the Walrus, they use take 17, but to get take 17 finished, they need to get take 25. So let's look at this. Sorry. Test. All right, so the four tracks on take 16, we have a tambourine, not tambourine, tambourine, the South Indian instrument, electric guitar, a full drum bounce, and something called a pianette. And then all four tracks then got bounced down to track number one on take 17, so that's take 16. They left this empty because they knew that they were going to do something later. Then bass and snare, so they're overdubbing, so the snare drum isn't cutting through enough, so they have to overdub doubling the snare. Lead vocals, that all gets bounced down. Take 17 gets bounced down to take one, to track one of take 20. Then we have bass, brass and a clarinet, violins and cellos, which of course George Martin arranged, and it's such a distinctive part of this track. And that's take 20 on track 4 of take 25 then, which includes take 17 on track 1. And then we have leave that empty, and we have another choral section. And then because they were smart and they left track 2 empty on track 17, all that can get bounced down back to track 2 on tape 17, and we get something that sounds like a live offhand performance. Think of how rationalized that is. You needed somebody behind the mixing desk keeping this all together. John Lennon very famously with Strawberry Fields Forever put up his hands and said, when George Martin said, look, the two takes you like, the first half is in one key and the other half's in the other key, we can't just splice them together. He said, I trust you, George, and he left, you know? So this thing is very rationalized. It's very piecemeal at this point in time, and it all works, though. This is not to say that it's not musical. It's just a different kind of musical.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
You have take 17 there.
Yep.
And you have a track empty. Is that a mix to, you have an empty track and you're mixing that?
Yes.
That empty track is
it stays empty.
But you won't find it if you're just mixing one track. Excuse me, if you're just mixing to one track.
Yes.
You're not going to find that empty track, right? Because it's all now. It's a.
That's right. That's right. It gets bounced down. That's right. And they go back to take 17 and fill it with take 25. These two are the same take. So they said, so we have that. They said, we have that. So we're just going to play that. We're going to bring out the second tape machine and do all our overdubs onto that. And we're going to try to sync it. And then when we have everything that we like, we'll dump it down onto track 2 of take 17.
So they have two machines then.
That's right.
So they can write.
That's the only way they could do this. The only way you can bounce down that way is with two machines. Yep. So we'll listen to a little bit and look at our edit slate. Are we good?
We're good. We're good. Everything's fine.
We should be able to get to it.
We should be able to slow this. We don't blow his fucking speakers up when we heard me run it through there.
Yeah. Just to test it, yeah. Another thing you'll notice that his voice is very overdriven, right? this was something John Lennon was always really insecure about his vocals, which I always found amazing. So he would often say to George Martin, pour some ketchup on it. That was his phrase, pour some ketchup on it. And George Martin always took that as, okay, he wants me to process it somehow. In order to get this overdrive on this vocal take, they actually rewired something called a talkback microphone, which was a microphone that they used, the producer would use to talk with the musicians in the live room on the mixer, and that's really given to overdrive. It's just a little tidbit. Right. Okay, I'm sorry, it's always a bummer that we have to stop it, but you do. Anyways, I've actually spoken to people. I'm always curious, anyone who's around, I always, you know, what was it like hearing this for the first time? And the responses I get are often really funny.
Who remembers
exactly? Yeah. Well, my father does. He really disliked. He was a big Bob Dylan fan, and he was a big Beatles fan too. But for something about this track in particular really irked him. So maybe that's why I was obsessed with it. Okay. Now, what I want to do before we get a little academic is I want now us to take a bit of time. It's about 6 minutes, but I want us to listen to George Martin deconstructing the mix for A Day in the Life. It's really fascinating, but think about everything that I've spoken to up until now, and he's going to take you through track by track by track what happened. And really pay attention, there's the really telling moments for our purposes tonight. From a production standpoint, it's ecstatic watching this, you know, you really geek out on it. But for our purposes tonight, the most important part is really listen to those moments where he says, well, we didn't know what we were going to do here, so we just held the, you know, that chord for 20 bars. And we'd figure it out later. And then we did some, and then we went on and did something else. You know, and then the way that this thing is put together, the band starts to use the recording studio as a musical instrument, right? They decide you don't have to have everything put out right away. You can listen, hear it as it's emerging and evolving, and try something else. If you're a Beatle, you can afford to do that, right? And George Martin was happy to do it with the band. But again, we have to keep in mind that a lot of the things, think about also the things that George Martin says about how he translated the band's vision. You know, you had someone like John Lennon walking in, or Paul McCartney. John Lennon very famously at one point said to George, you know, George is saying, I'm not really, what are you hearing here? And he sort of says, well, I want to hear the end of the world and the entire world being sucked through a faucet. Right, that, when you're in the studio, you like to hear things like, can you give me a 3 dB bump at about 7K, right? You know, and something like that, you'd say, okay. but you know, the thing is, too, what's really interesting, too, is you can hear the affection in George Martin, especially when he had something, there was something sort of special. I think they had a bit of a special bond between him and John Lennon. You can just hear the affection, you know, and that he really got a kick out of him, and that he thought he had really great musical instincts, and he just didn't have the training to articulate it in a way that would make perfect sense to him. But he got it, you know. So again, the quality on this video's kind of poor, apologies, but hey, we're talking about acid rock, we can pretend that I have spiked your drinks, and this is what we're seeing.
A Day in the Life was the last track to be found on Sgt. Pepper. And I first heard it with John just playing his guitar and singing in front of me. So this is what we heard. Record.
That was the stool test, right? They would play the song and George Martin would say, okay.
Take four.
Two, three, four.
All the rhythm there. All on one track. John, his voice on track four.
I read the news today.
Wonderful voice.
About a lucky man who made a play.
I never really liked it very much, which is why we always put this kind of double tape echo, which he loved to hear himself.
And we'll talk about that echo a little bit later.
There's no bass or drums on it yet. We edit it later, and we still have only two friends. But it's still pretty big. On the 20th of Jan, we started work again to add.
Is there any way I can get a tiny bit of water?
Sure, did you want ice or no?
That'd be great.
A little bit of percussion from our fifth year. Sure. And this was the result.
Taking a break. Thank you. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
There's a bit of extra piano on the beginning of one hour of your track, as well as bass. They're playing away. Later on, we'll hear Ringo joining in on the toms. We'll be doing it live, of course.
Well, I just had to laugh. I saw the photograph. He blew his mind out in a car.
Ringo coming in.
He didn't notice that the light.
These days we would have the luxury of devoting a whole track to drum and taking as much time as we wanted. But we didn't have that much in those days. We still didn't know what we were going to do in this long 23 bars. So it was slow. But Paul had written the middle bit by now. And he had to still do his voice. So we dropped it in on the original vocal track in this section here. Come here. Again on the vocal track.
Walker. Out of bed, black comb across my head. On the way upstairs.
Sound effects, courtesy of John Lennon.
Oh, yeah. I don't have a face. Found the coat, grabbed my hat. Made the bus, made the flat.
All the time, George and John and Paul were wondering what we're going to do in the middle bit. And I don't know whether it's Paul or if it's John. Probably. They're both and said, let's have a big orchestral sound. Let's have a symphony orchestra. Let's get them in and tell them to play anything. I said, you can't get an orchestra to come in and play anything. You write something. So I said, well, let's have a big orchestral orgasm. A big clamor. I asked them what they wanted. And they said, well, let's start off with the lowest note on each instrument, as quiet as possible, and end up on the highest note as hard as possible. So that's a pretty simple brief. So that's what we did. All I did was just write the score. So our orchestral climax, the musical orgasm, had a score which started with the lowest note of each instrument, the quietest possible fashion, rising to the very highest note, and loudest possible, over 24 bars. And each bar gave a little signpost to show roughly where the musicians would be at any one time. But I had to give them a bit of an explanation as well. It was no good just playing the notes as written. And these were the finest musicians you could get in London. And for years they'd been taught to play as one man. I suddenly said to them, don't listen to the fellow next door to you. Play, make your own way up this huge climax. And if you're playing anything like the fellow next door to you, you're playing a wrong note. It worked. We still needed a finisher there. And it had to be something that wasn't orchestral. We had already done that. And this was one of those bright ideas that just didn't work. We thought of all the ideas of Buddhist monks chanting. Thought it'd be a great idea to have everybody massed in the studio doing aum and hanging on to it and multiply it many times. And the result was pathetic. So then we went over to the idea of pianos, and that was a better one. I've always been fascinated by the sounds of a piano strings if you bang them and leave it loud pedal. And this was the basis of our last chord. So we got everybody that was available to play a chord on the piano. We had three people on one piano, and several pianos at once. And we recorded many of them, one after the other, on four tracks, of course. And in fact, on the third track, we added an organ. And at the same time, Jeff Emmerich, the engineer, would bring up the faders in the dialway. We all get very, very quiet, so that the ringing of the pianos went on and on and on. Like this.
One, two, three.
Yeah. Goes on forever.
Sustain. Okay, so because of time issues, we're going to skip over all the academic part. Aww. It, you know, and I even at home when I was preparing the lecture, I was like, it's classrooms without quizzes. It's not a Beatles fan club, it's classrooms. whatever. Anyways, the point ultimately, so you've just listened to my brilliant academic discourse, you're all convinced that my PhD was well earned. And all I'll say is that the way that we, well, and now we're at the end. I've got you, you're just absolutely, yes, so what's the point? This is a McLuhan idea. I figured I'd take someone who's very influential in the acid rock years and apply it to the records and to what I'm trying to get across. And this is his idea of the rear view mirror. Anytime we have a new medium, we of course try to find the familiar in it, right? So his famous little pithy aphorism is, the past went that away when faced with a totally new situation, we tend always to attach ourselves to the objects, to the flavor of the most recent past. We look at the present through a rearview mirror. We march backwards into the future. Suburbia lives imaginatively in Bonanza Land.